Hello everyone. So today we are going to solve a problem on channel transitions, basically hump. Okay, so this problem is based on the flow over hump. So first we'll read the problem. A rectangular channel has a width of 2 meters and carries a discharge of 4.8 meter cube per second with a depth of 1.6 meters. So we are given that the channel is rectangular. We are also given the discharge. We know the width of the channel. We are given the discharge. And what is the uniform flow depth of the incoming flow? Okay, this data is given to us. Now, what is asked? At a certain section, a small smooth hump with a flat top and height of 0.1 meters. So, a hump of 0.1 meters height is proposed to be built. So, what we need to calculate? Calculate the likely change in the water surface and neglect the energy losses. Alright, so basically a rectangular cross section is there, a rectangular open channel cross section is there, width of the section is 2 meters, width is 2 meters, what is the discharge that is flowing, it is 4.8 meter cube per second and the flow depth, initial flow depth is 1.6 meters. Okay. So we need to find out the changes. Okay, first we'll draw the figure of the flow and then we will discuss what is asked basically. Okay. So let's draw it first. So you have an incoming flow, the incoming flow depth is 1.6 meters, alright, so the flow depth is 1.6 meters, then the flow encounters a hump, okay, a hump is placed in the flow, the height of this hump is 0.1 meters. So this is delta z 0.1 meters, alright, okay. Now the question is, if this flow passes over this hump, what will happen to both the depths, like what will happen to the incoming flow depth and what will happen to the flow depth on the hump? So this is the basically what we want to know. What are the likely changes in the water surfaces? Okay, so we will not approach this problem by any procedure, but we will just approach this problem conceptually and try to get the answers. Okay, so no need to follow any fixed procedure. We will just do it intuitively by applying our concepts of specific energy. Okay, all right. So the first thing that we need to find out is whether the flow is subcritical or supercritical, because we have seen that behavior is opposite for both the type of flows. Okay, so for the discussion purpose, I'll still keep one specific energy curve. Okay, because we'll refer to the same curve for the entire problem. I'll draw it here. So this is your specific energy curve for 4.8 meter cube per second. Okay, so the first question which we need to ask ourselves is if the flow is in subcritical region or supercritical region. Okay, so in order to find that out, we know what is the property of subcritical or supercritical flow. We can find that out very easily by calculating either the critical depth. You can compare the critical depth with this normal depth, or you can just find out the Froude number at the upstream. Okay, we can find our Froude number. It is a simple thing. So Froude number at section 1. This is your section 1. This is your section 2. So Froude number is what?
Velocity upon under root g d1.
V by under root g d1. V1 is the average velocity here. So average velocity, let's calculate that. V1 will be equal to q by a1. Okay. And so that is q is 4.8 upon a1 is the flow area. Here how much is the flow area? Base width into height. Base width is 2 and flow depth is 1.6. Okay. 1.6 meters. So let's find the V1. Calculate it. So that is 4.8 upon 2 into 1.6. So that is 1.5 meters per second. This is the flow velocity at the upstream. Okay, so this is your flow velocity of the incoming flow. Velocity of the incoming flow. Now, you know the velocity, so you can calculate the Froude number, but we need the hydraulic depth also. Now, for rectangular channel, hydraulic depth is equal to the flow depth itself. Okay, so this is 1.5 upon under root 9.81 into d1 is nothing but y1, so 1.6. So, Froude number we are going to get 1.5 upon root of 9.81 into 1.6. So it should be less than 1. Now it is coming 0.37. So less than 1.
Bolo sir.
Theek hai bolo. Pause kar karo. Alright, so Froude number is less than 1. So Froude number is less than 1 means flow, incoming flow is in subcritical region. Incoming flow is subcritical. So we are somewhere here. But for that we need to again find the specific energy as well. Okay. So once we know the Froude number, we know that we are in the subcritical region. Okay. Fine. So second step is just finding out the specific energy at E1. That is Y1 plus V1 square by 2G. Okay, so that is y1 is 1.6 plus v1 is 1.5 square by 2 into 9.81. So we are getting e1 as 1.6 plus 1.5 square upon 2 into 9.81. So 1.714. meters. Okay, the unit will be meters. So now we know that fine, the energy of the incoming flow, the specific energy E1 of the incoming flow is 1.714 meters. Okay, now if we plot this or if we extend it on the specific energy curve, we know that Froude number is less than 1. So basically this specific energy, for this particular specific energy, this discharge 4.8 meters per second can be occurring at two different depths. One is supercritical and one is subcritical. But now since we calculated that Froude number, it is less than 1. So this must be a subcritical depth. So this is your Y1 basically. This is your 1.6. Y1 is, okay, it is 1.6. Okay, now first, again, once you know, then you can easily say that if you put a hump in this flow, the flow depth is going to decrease. Flow depth on the hump is going to decrease. Okay, because in subcritical flow, decrease in specific energy causes a decrease in depth also. Okay, if you decrease the specific energy, your flow depth will also decrease. Okay. So let's find it out. So now we will calculate E2. Okay. Now E2 is equal to What should be E2? Suppose you put your delta Z. Now here there is a hump. Okay. Because of the hump, the specific energy will decrease. Isn't it? Suppose this is your total energy line. Okay. So now here specific energy is E1. It is this much. But at this point, specific energy is going to decrease. By how much amount? By delta Z. So E2 will be equal to E1 minus delta Z. So that is equal to E1 is 1.714 minus 0.1. Okay. So 1.614 meters. Okay. So this will be your A2. Now we know the energy at section 2. Okay. But where it is lying? Is it less than E minimum or greater than E minimum? See, this is your E minimum. E minimum or EC, whatever you can call. So we should also know that where your energy at this section lies. Whether it is greater than E minimum, whether this E2 is greater than E minimum or less than E minimum. That also we have to compare. So first we will find out E minimum, and for that we need the critical depth. Okay. To find that YC, what we need? We need the E minimum. Okay. For E minimum we will need YC, and YC can be easily calculated. Critical depth in this channel, critical depth for rectangular channel is cube root of small q square by g. That is equal to cube root of small q is what? Capital Q, 4.8 divided by width. Discharge per unit width. And width is 2 meters. Okay, width is 2 meters. So critical depth will be, just calculate, simple calculation, cube root of q square. So that is 4.8 divided by 2 square by 9.81. So we are getting 0.837 meters. Okay, and E minimum is, or EC is, this is the specific energy associated with this critical depth. That means the specific energy minimum for this discharge, that is, we know that the relation is 3/2 YC. So it is into 3/2. It is 1.256 meters. Okay. Now if you see, where is your E2 and where is your E minimum? You see, E minimum is (coughs) 1.256 meters. Okay. But the available energy at this hump, available energy at this hump section is 1.614. So it is greater, as E2 is greater than E minimum. So E2 will lie somewhere here. Okay. This is your E2. Because it is 1.614. Okay. 1.614. So if for this particular E2, what should happen to your depths y1 and y2? See, will your y1 change? No. Why? Because your hump, height of the hump, delta z, is less than the delta z m. This will be your delta z m. Okay. Why? Because the energy that is available at the hump is actually greater than E minimum. So it will lie in between. Okay. So delta z is not less than, or is not greater than delta z m. Okay. Therefore y1 is not going to change. Okay. When will y1 change? If your delta z is such that it is greater than delta z m, that means if you calculate E2 and you find that this energy is actually less than E minimum, then both depths are going to change. Okay, then y1 is also going to change. But here y1 is not going to change, fine. But what will happen to y2? Y2 will definitely decrease, because now by placing a hump we have decreased the specific energy. So for this particular specific energy, y2 is less than y1, and we want to find this y2. Okay, so how to find y2? For y2, how much is the specific energy? E2. Just by this expression you can calculate. Okay, y1 will remain unchanged. Okay, I'll write it here. Remain unchanged. And what about y2? Let's calculate y2 here. Now for y2, use the expression for specific energy at this location. Specific energy at 2 will be equal to y2 plus v2 square by 2g. So that will be y2 plus q square by 2g is a2 square. Okay. Again, you can expand this y2 plus q square by 2 into 9.81 into 2 into y2 square. Okay. So energy at 2, we know, we have calculated E2, 1.614. 1.614 is equal to y2 is unknown plus q is 4.8 square upon 2 into 9.81 into 4 into y2 square. Okay, so convert this into the cubic equation, because we are going to get a cubic equation, y2 square multiplied by y2. So again, simplify this. 1.614 is equal to y2 plus, now take the numerical value, it will be 4.8 square upon 2 into 9.81 into 4, 0.293 upon y2 square. So multiply, cross multiply, and we will get 1.614 is equal to y2 cube plus 0.293 upon y2 square. So we have y2 cube minus 1.614 y2 square plus 0.293 equal to 0. Okay, so if you solve this equation in the calculator, go to calculator, go to equations, go to number 4, that is cubic equation, and put the coefficients of y cube, y square, y and numerical constant, and get the answer. So coefficient of y2 cube is 1, put a as 1, y square is minus 1.614. Okay, coefficient of y is 0. Okay, and numerical constant is 0.293. So basically you are going to get three answers. So y2 is equal to, so minus 0.38, then ...1.48... and 0.516. Okay, now negative value is not possible, so cancel it. Now you have two options, 1.48 or 0.516. Okay, so which might be correct? See, a larger depth will always represent subcritical flow. For a particular same specific energy, larger depth is subcritical depth, smaller depth is a supercritical depth. Now we are in the subcritical region, so your depth must be subcritical. So this is your answer, it will be 1.48. okay, so now what has happened? See, this depth is, y1 was 1.6, now the depth has decreased to 1.48. Okay, so flow was taking place in this way, but now because of the hump the depth has decreased. So this y2 is equal to 1.48. okay, this much is the y2. Okay, since there was no energy loss, energy line was horizontal. If you are given energy loss HL, then you can just balance that HL in this equation. Okay, HL will come in this equation for finding out the correct E2. Okay. So what is our answer basically? When you place a hump of 0.1 meters, the flow depth at the upstream will not change. This will remain 1.6. Okay, this will remain 1.6 itself. But what will happen to the depth on the hump? It will decrease to 1.48. Okay. This is how we can solve the questions of flow over hump. Like just by looking at the, always keep in mind to draw the specific energy curve. So all the points you will get on the specific energy curve, how to calculate, what to do, etc. Okay, thank you.